I was proud of Madeline. The first thing on her list was she wants me to donate money to charity in her name.
Nice.
All right. Church points.
Folks in need to be taken care of. Jordan.
First spiritual one?
Yep.
New golf clubs.
New golf clubs.
Probably new swing clubs.
Golf clubs out. Yeah, well said, sir.
Terrorists to go away.
Yeah, terrorism to go away.
I'd like to have marginalized people of the world better understood.
Yeah.
This is where terrorism is coming from. It's not coming out of this country. It's coming out of people that live in the slums around Paris. That just are profiled when they run around and don't have the same opportunities as other people in their society. And instead of war breaking out, I think I'd like to have love break out. And I know that's an impossible thing to have happen, but that's what I'd break
for. A breakout of love. That'd be beautiful. All these things, whether it's golf clubs or whether it's more love in the world, whether it's better understanding for each other, these are all desires and needs that we have that we would like to see happen in the future. And if they were to happen, it would be a better future. That's what hope is all about. And usually we hope for things that we don't already have, right? If we hope for a peaceful family gathering, it's because family gatherings tend to go sideways. If we hope for new golf clubs, it's because our swing is going a little bit sideways. Oh, sorry, man. That was so wrong. So wrong. But I honestly have to admit, I'm hope disabled or hope challenged, perhaps. I'm not so good at hoping, which may seem weird as a pastor. I should be an expert at it, but I'm not. And I have two really strong reasons why. One is that I think I have a tendency to hope for the wrong things. And so if I get my 50-inch curved TV and my Seahawks season tickets, they will make me happy for a time, but I don't know if they'll actually make me a better person or a more fulfilled person. But the other reason is I get disappointed. Somewhere along the way, I learned after hoping in things that if I hope for the wrong things, they have a tendency to break down and not be able to provide me what I was hoping for, and then I'm disappointed. And somewhere along the way, I go, man, it's just easier to just roll with things how they are, not hope for too much, don't set the bar too high, because if that were to happen, then I'll probably end up disappointed. I know, what a downer for Christmas, man. Who let that guy up there with the mic? So in the midst of this, thinking about hope and being challenged with hope, I read something profound by Eugene Peterson, and he was talking about hope. And he basically said, in your life, it's like a garden. You have all this space, and hope is supposed to be growing in all these areas. But if it doesn't grow, what you get instead is weeds. You get cynicism and despair and hopelessness and bitterness and callousness. And we all know that the world has plenty of that. You and I don't need any more of that. The world that God loves doesn't need any more of that. And so we desperately need hope. We need a hope that's actually worth putting our hope in. That'll stand up to the test of time and will last. So, today, as we kind of consider the scripture together, I'm hoping that God adds some things to our list. That God gives us some hopes in Him that will last, that are worth hoping in, and that can provide us with a vision for the future that can move us forward. So, I'm going to read Isaiah 9, 1 through 7. You've already heard part of it. You heard verses 6 and 7. But I'm going to read this passage and then pray and then share some thoughts about it. So, this is Isaiah 9, 1 through 7. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. In the past, He humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future, He will honor Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation. You've increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoicing at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning. It'll be fuel for a fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Pray. God, speak to us. We come in with celebratory hearts and with struggling hearts. And so let your spirit lead us here. Speak to us through these words. We love you. Amen. This passage begins with gloom. People walking in gloom. And it was a dark, dark gloom. These words were written 700 years before Jesus Christ came on the scene. Isaiah spoke these words to a group of people who had just been conquered by Assyria. They had not only lost a battle, they had lost their homes, they had lost their belongings. They were, a remnant of them were dispersed to be slaves throughout the Assyrian Empire. And in the midst of that hopelessness, in the midst of that darkness, Isaiah prophesies these words about Jesus. In Jesus' day, Mary and Joseph, they were Israelites. They were living under Roman occupation. They were heavily taxed. They were in poverty. There was not a lot of hope. It was a depressed depressed nation, and they lived in particular in Galilee. And Galilee was kind of looked down on because when the Assyrians had come through and dispersed everybody, there had been a lot of intermarriage, and those folks happened to have a lot of racial pride, and so it turned into racism. So this particular area of Israel was looked down on as the worst of the worst. Nothing good could come from there. So when we send around that Christmas card, that pristine picture of Jesus sitting in a little manger with peaceful animals, and of course Jesus not crying like that baby who was just baptized, doesn't cry at all. It's kind of an idealized picture. But this was a real world dark situation into which hope had come. And I was thinking about it, we kind of do this in life, you know, we greet each other with a Merry Christmas, but just below the surface, there's some mess there. There's definitely celebration, but there's some struggle there. And in the midst of that, I think this word is also for us. It's a word of hope. And the passage presents for us a reason for hope, something that's actually worth hoping in today. And if we don't have a hope that can enter into these places, that can actually stand up longer than the enjoyment of a 50-inch TV, then the cynicism and the bitterness and the weeds can creep in. And so, to having a life that doesn't have apathy and cynicism and bitterness, and to having burdens that are light and easy, I think it's useful to have this kind of hope. I hope that can last forever. And what's beautiful about this passage is that Isaiah doesn't say, here's what Jesus is going to do to set everything right, which, I mean, I would like to hear that too, but I think it would be a longer passage. But instead, he says, here's what impact Christ has on people. And the first impact that's coming when we have Christ in our life is joy. Let me read verse 3 again. You've enlarged the nation. You've increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing plunder. That is a lot of joy, friends. A lot of rejoicing. And joy is this deep sense of happiness that that is stronger than just opening a box from Nordstrom and getting to be boots that we really wanted. It's this satisfaction that goes through all circumstances in our life. We can have joy even in the midst of hard seasons. And these people were in a hard season, and we may be in a hard season. They had just had their nation not enlarged, but cut down in size. A remnant remained. He says, you'll rejoice as men dividing plunder. They had just watched men divide all their belongings. They saw that joy. Now, this was hopeless, and yet Isaiah says, in Christ, you can find this joy. I don't know what it is that's sucking the life out of you. I hope that you didn't just get conquered and plundered. But my guess is there's stuff. There's stuff that sucks the life out of you and where you feel like you're running thin and where it feels like your margins are gone. And Isaiah says, with Christ, you can have joy in the midst of that. Do you need joy? Do you need an abundance in your life right now? If you do, knowing Christ can help bring that. And I don't know what's taken away your joy. I know that there's a lot of reasons it can be taken away. And God wants to give us in the midst of that hope. It might take a while. We're pretty broken. I'm pretty broken. You're pretty broken. We all live in the same place, and we have a tendency to run into each other and create brokenness. So we need some of this hope. But when Christ comes again, all those things will set right. Be set right. And that is a crazy, crazy, awesome hope. But in the midst of whatever it is we're in, joy can give us a spring in our step. It can give us a little more patience. It can help the things that normally get under our skin roll off our back. Joy in the midst. That's a beautiful thing. The second thing that Christ gives us is freedom. Verse 4. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders and the rod of their oppressors. A yoke. Something you put on an oxen, makes it like plow straight. And these folks had perhaps been led away from their homes wearing the yoke. Syrians put it on them and said, all right, you're going to walk in this line together. A rod on their shoulders, be chained to and directed. A rod, their oppressor's rod on their backs. Now, hopefully we're not living in slavery. But we don't feel free either, do we? We don't experience full freedom. Imagine a world with no bad habits, with no injustice, with no broken family patterns, with nobody who's feeling powerless or neglected or marginalized. Imagine a world where there isn't any addictions or insecurities or power plays or racism. Imagine a world where you're free from the pain of poor choices and you're free from the experience of other people's poor choices. Imagine bodies that are healthy and healed instead of unhealthy. That's abundant life, and that's what freedom looks like, free to fully live. When I came to Christ, I experienced some of that. That freedom can kind of come in. I had a relationship with my family that wasn't very free. We were at each other a lot. And as Christ came into my life, I got softened up and learned to say, I'm sorry. And I learned to make peace with my family. And now I'm free. It's a beautiful thing. God doesn't want us running around burdened and chained and carrying heavy loads. He comes to give us that freedom. Without freedom, it's a little bit like, you ever break an arm or break a leg or have an injury, you know, you get put in a cast and you can function, or maybe you have a limp for a while. You can function, you still go about your life, you do it. And I think most of us can get by pretty well how we are. We somehow made it this far and we'll keep on going, even if we're like limping around. But that's just how fast we go right now. It's that. But I was on YouTube of all things, and I'm watching this little video of this little greyhound, and there was this thing on what 3D printers can do, and they can do some pretty cool stuff, and they had printed up this little contraption that had wheels on the back and fit this dog perfectly right around his hips, and he didn't have hind legs, been in an accident, so this greyhound is like dragging himself around doing his life. And then they put this little contraption on him and put him out in the yard. And this dog just took off. And he's running and he's running and he is made to run. And when you see a greyhound who's made to run, able to run again for the first time, you can't help but laugh and celebrate. And I was in shock by it. And then it struck me. All of us are a little bit disabled right now. We're all walking around with a limp. We all have some brokenness. And when Christ comes and sets us free, we're not going to have that. And we're going to run. And we're going to live like we were made to live. That's freedom. Last one is peace. Hope for peace. Verse 5 is, every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood is destined for burning. It's fuel for a fire. Grace and forgiveness in Christ offers us peace. Peace with God. God no longer needs to be our enemy, and we no longer need to defend ourselves. Because things are at peace. When people are at peace, they're reconciled. They no longer have anything against each other. There's no need for war. In the times that I'm most at peace with my wife or with my family is when I'm walking closest with the Lord. Times that I'm most patient with a stranger or gracious under stress is when the Lord is close and I've spent time with him. God wants us to be at peace in really tangible ways with him and with other people. And this picture of taking all the stuff for war and just burning it, let it become a fire. It's like Isaiah 2:4, it says, take your spears in your and make them into pruning hooks, and take your swords and make them into plows, because you're not going to need them for war anymore. All that energy spent fighting is now spent producing something beautiful. That's what Christ is bringing, and ultimately, Christ will bring peace to the world. Imagine that. No more strife between peoples. No more nations against each other. All wars end. That is a crazy big hope. A life with more joy and freedom and peace and brought to its complete fullness. That is where we're headed. And that's what we celebrate at Christmas. And that's why this season is meaningful. But is this hope? hope actually realistic. That's utopia right there that I just painted, or rather that Isaiah painted. Is that a realistic hope? Can that happen? I mean, I would hope to win the lottery. My brother finally convinced me that it might be a good thing. I'd hope to win that, but that's not likely to happen, so I'm not going to put a lot of hope in it. But this stuff that I just talked about, this vision for the future, well, here's what Isaiah says about it. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. And he will reign on David's throne over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on forever. And here's the kicker. The zeal of the Lord Almighty can accomplish. I don't know how much you've strived for joy and freedom and peace, but my attempts to bring it about for myself have not produced a large amount of it. And yet this says that God can produce it for us and in us and through us. He's the Wonderful Counselor. His counsel can direct our lives into really good places. He's the Mighty God. He's the one who actually has the strength to make it happen. He's the Everlasting Father. He's around long after we were are ready to give up. He's always there for us. And he's the Prince of Peace. He can actually create peace. Before becoming a pastor, I had toyed around with being an elementary school teacher or a middle school teacher. My dad was a middle school teacher. And I thought, that'd be fun. I like kids. And I realized I'm really good at summer camp and I'd be a horrible teacher because I'm not organized. I'm not structured. I don't like routines. Like, having fun with kids is fantastic for me, but I'm pretty sure we wouldn't learn very much that year. The kids might really like me. The parents might not really like me when their kids hadn't learned very much that year. And then I met Christina, my wife, and she was an excellent elementary school teacher for many years. She is structured and organized and loves routines, and it drives her absolutely crazy that I can't do routine to save my life. But she can get in a classroom and those kids just thrive. And this picture that I just was reading for you out of Isaiah says that Christ actually is uniquely capable. He is able to produce in our lives and in this world something that we couldn't possibly do on our own. We just don't have the skill set for it, but God does. And if we put our hope in something and expect it to bring us that joy and that freedom and that peace, and it's not able to produce it, we expect too much of it, and then we're disappointed. But putting our hope in Christ says that that's not a hope that will disappoint us, because he will and can and does. And ultimately, he will completely do it. And if we get our hope put there, it can actually change our lives. What we hope for dictates how we do our life. If I'm hoping for a new espresso machine for Christmas, I will put a picture of it up on the fridge. I'll start talking about how awesome it is to my wife. I'll hint at how great that would be to have that coffee machine. I would promise to make a latte every morning. So, it's already begun to affect my life. Let's say my hope is for a promotion at work, right? I'll start looking at that person's job that I'm really hoping to end up in and go, man, what would it take to do that? And I'll start thinking of things that I could do in that particular job if I were to have it, and I'll start learning what I can about that job. It changes us. If my hope is to see a family gathering this holiday season, I need to start looking at plane tickets. It's that time. I need to get that going. And the same is true when we put our hope in Christ. It begins to dictate the way that we do our lives, because we begin to look to Christ for things like peace when we're having a hard day, or patience when we're in conflict with other people, or grace and forgiveness when we run across our own faults and our own mistakes. So I don't know what's on your Christmas list, and I don't know where the struggles are or where the victories are, but I'm pretty sure that adding Christ to the list is something worth focusing on this Christmas, is better than having an iPod. Maybe even season tickets to the Seahawks, I am. Yeah. And I don't know what following Christ looks like to you. I don't know if it's just starting to come to church or inviting some friends with you to Christmas Eve, or taking time to read Jesus' accounts, the accounts of his life in Scripture. And I'm pretty sure God is pretty good at telling us what the next step is. So I trust him to do that. But But I do know that coming into this holiday season, we have a hope. And it's a hope of greater joy and greater freedom and greater peace for our lives. So with that, let's pray. God, thanks for your great gifts. Thanks that you come up with better gifts than we can ever imagine or could ever ask for. Thanks that you can produce things in our lives that we can't, like joy and freedom and peace. Thanks for a hope of a world that is one day set right. And what a big, durable, incredible hope that is. Help us to pour our lives in that direction. Thanks for loving us. We love you too.